from the technology. The aspect to note out here is 9% of our GDP gets contributed by this industry. So you can understand the significance and the kind of gravitas it carries in terms of the overall weightage to our economy of our country. Next, please. I think when we all look at this entire thing, I think whether we are talking today about the velocity or the high quantum of data, which is getting more amplified by 5G and the evolution around quantum computing. One of the aspects which, as we talk about, even this slide is getting obsolete in terms of how we kind of really look at not only kind of aggregating data, but the shift of a lot of that conversations has happened more about what do we do with this data. Now, just to give an example, while we look at all these set of zettabytes which are getting generated on a daily, weekly, annual basis, we're talking about one zettabyte, which is equivalent to all the movie titles on the Netflix put together, multiplied by 370 million times. That's a kind of a data deluge we are talking about in today's world. And if that's not enough, next. We also have the whole aspect about the digital data. I mean, it's not a surprise in terms of how we consume information, how we kind of really transact or kind of experience different product and services on the digital. So a combination of what we say proprietary and digital data is rather, to me, throwing unprecedented challenges as well as possibilities for the companies to really look in terms of what they should be doing. Next. And this is where, when we look at the aspects about why we are so gung-ho about, why we are so excited and fascinated about analytics AI industry, and this is coming from multiple reports emerging from our interaction with the customers and end users. One of the key aspects which is driving today analytics AI adoption is the ability for AI and analytics, one, to really look at how the top line gets more accentuated, more augmented, and also in terms of the cost containment through various levers kind of a thing. The other critical aspect for analytics AI is also about how much do you know about your consumers. Customers never had so good about the preferences, what we do through micro segmenting, hyper personalization, really going deep in terms of creating a very, very good halo impact on the customer experience. And then we are talking about the whole leverageability in terms of how we consume information, which is more about decision making. Next. And this is where, in one snapshot, we wanted to capture, we've taken 9 of possible 40 different industry segments existed. And pretty much through the infographic, you can make out what these industries are. I think today there is a significant shift in terms of how analytics AI is consumed today. The very reason we're talking about this change is, you look at the value chain today. Just a few years back, ICICI Bank, to process a credit card for you, used to take about 16 different steps from a time you kind of contact someone from a customer associate, kind of a, let's say, helpline, to the time you land up in terms of a credit card. It was a 16-step process. Today, we are talking about the same process getting done in 3 steps. And that's all because of how analytics AI is really leveraged in terms of disrupting the value chain and creating new value chains for the business. And that's where we are talking about transformation, innovation coming through analytics and AI. Now, I just want to take a very quick peep into what we are talking about. As I mentioned, the value chain disruptions or the new business models which are emerging through analytics AI. Some total of about 3-4 industries we've taken as an example, and I won't delve into the details, but it could give you a sneak peek into what's up in terms of the changes, what's happening in terms of the various application adoption scenario which exists today. And the reason why we are also trying to just demonstrate this is with an extrapolation of the number of opportunities which is coming together in terms of AI and analytics professionals being employed, or the opportunities which are open today for all of us to kind of fulfill. Case in point, insurance. I think the thing around how do you, in fact, look at the data you cannot reach. a recent example of Australia, where the bushfires really kind of damaged a lot of, I would say, species of animals, a lot of, I would say, loss in terms of property. Insurance companies were not able to reach in terms of the spot identification. Drones were sent, drones were trying to analyze through the images, and a possible algorithm working in the background for the TPAs resulted into an extent of understanding what are the possible damages for that particular site or that particular location. And for that, insurers were ready to kind of do an on-spot claim verification in terms and settlement, what needs to be done. And that's where telematics is coming very, very prominent. Next, please. We take the retail scenario. I think we are all very, I would say, peculiar about when we walk into retail stores in terms of what we need to pick or what we need to kind of choose in terms of product. But those were the days. Today, as we walk into the stores, any retail kind of a stores, we are greeted with messages as we walk in. We are thrown those discount and loyalty coupons. And to top it all, some of the stores have created experience centers, which is all reflected and underpinned by artificial intelligence. As you stand in front of a mirror, the mirror already has your body dimensions in terms of a face getting captured because you have shopped or kind of transacted in that retail store in the past. You are a frequent kind of a shopper for them, and your entire body dimensions get more kind of, let's say, possible in terms of new trends of the apparels and the fashion line coming and getting displayed on your body right in front of you in 15 to 20 seconds. You don't have to go to the trial rooms or stand in terms of the queues to get your kind of, let's say, new lines tried. It's just coming right in front of you. I mean, as you can see it. And that's the level of data-driven decision-making which is happening in the retail stores. Of course, not to forget a huge shift in terms of how inventory management is also done by the stores today in terms of the just-in-time approach, which is being leveraged by analytics and AI. And as we move into the CPG industries, we know today how, as you understand, the products are getting hyper-personalized. I mean, if we look at Amazon, we look at Flipkart, I mean, they work with millions of merchant establishments, and the whole set of creating products is based on the data which the CPG companies are today looking in terms of how do you augment that entire customer experience. Assortment, merchandising, the piece around supply chain for CPG companies, every aspect of this value chain for the CPG companies is getting highlighted and amplified by AI and analytics. Well, healthcare, I think we all realize today what today AI has done in terms of really looking at how radiology is changing as a profession. The things around looking at analyzing x-rays, CT scans, MRIs, and taking those spot decisions, which on an average, a radiologist used to take 15 to 20 minutes, is a game changer. Plus, the whole advent of wearables in terms of not only measuring our key health metrics, but that data kind of getting shared with multiple other players in terms of how it can reflect in terms of determining our health insurance premium is also a testimony in terms of how AI is getting really permeated into healthcare. And life sciences, if we really move into that particular aspect, is also untouched. Purely because we didn't have any kind of a blockbuster drug from last few years. So what's happened outside of the commercial side of life sciences companies, where analytics has been very, very smart, embedded, pervasive for multiple years. Suddenly, we see a kind of a rush for the life sciences companies to really look at clinical trial kind of, let's say, analysis, or really looking at the RWE side of the analytics, or even looking at how does the whole genetic sequencing happens in terms of how AI and analytics can touch the value chain for the life sciences companies. And not to forget the things around research and development and supply chain, which continues to penetrate the whole value chain for the life sciences company. And I think one of the aspects which looking at other industries, and particularly today, media and entertainment, I think Netflix revolutionized in terms of how we should consume what we need to see. The recommendation engine approach is a template for everyone. Now, when we look at this entire aspect about the new OTT players which are emerging, which are streaming those content in terms of different genres, what you would like to see or what you would like to kind of consume, is something which is throwing unprecedented possibilities for new production houses and studios to come out with the new formats of the content. And this is something which is also getting more translated into, as you've seen and kind of really experienced, is about the education. The things around what we say adaptive learning, which is more about the new approach in education called heutagogy, is a game-changing aspect. Bit size information getting captured, it's streaming to you. You can learn and absorb at your own pace. You can kind of pick up the credits what you want, and you really get qualified in terms of not just kind of doing an online assessment, but also participating in the hackathons or the Kaggles of the world, and making you more like a holistic professional for anything you would like to learn, rather than just looking at a textbookish approach. So that's outside of what I said. I think seemingly, if we see today how our life decision-making capability is also getting enhanced through analytics AI, I think the art of possible or the problem solving through AI is something what the next 3-4 years will lead to. And that's the segment which I want to address very quickly in terms of today. We have challenges today. Students who are aspiring to be kind of into analytics and AI, professionals who already have spent few years, need to understand where this entire set of headwinds and tailwinds are moving on analytics AI. I think one of the provocative statement I want to make, AI alone is not enough. You can have the best of the algorithms, you can have the best of the models, unless there is a very high set of data engineering capability. Can we have the full slide, please, out here? And a design element. And design is just not a cool or a very kind of a, let's say, jazzy UI UX. It's also the cognitive neuroscience and behavioral science, which is to drive more user adoption, which is what we call, how do you design for a subconscious mind? And that's where the problem solving for the companies, and it's often a kind of a, let's say, I would say more of an angst, resentment, and kind of a rant from the companies that, look, analytics and AI professionals do not understand our problems. And it's important because we always try to look and say, okay, can we craft a very good self-learning, machine-enabled, ensemble techniques-led algorithm? That's not the case. I think it's a blend of AI, engineering, and design, which will drive the future of artificial intelligence and AI. Next slide, please. Now, that's where, if we just look at this analogy of AI, data engineering, and design, we got to reflect on a couple of things. And I take these three model templates of the company. Google, everyone knows that how exactly they look at solving every problem, what comes to them from an engineering mindset. The things around standardization, automation, putting that engineering mindset at scale is their value differentiators. Amazon, everyone has really looked in terms of how Amazon has grown. Their aspect of operational dexterity, how they put the best of the processes in terms of making it much more amplified at scale, is there another kind of, let's say, prowess. And Apple, they create the category of their own, which is more from a design aspect. Minimal design, maximum usability is their motto. Now, this is where we say the engineering, AI, and the design aspect comes into the picture. Now, over there, for learners, and irrespective of the age, experience, tenure, and kind of, let's say, knowledge we are carrying, one of the aspects we talk about is no one today is an expert in AI and analytics. We are all evolving, we are all learning. And the next level of learning will come with what I say in my own kind of theory is about inch wide, mile deep strategy of learning, which is more about how do we cover the breadth of the discipline and go deep into few of the areas where we want to specialize.
Hello, guys. Samir, are you audible? Can you guys hear me?
Rohan, we just lost Samir.
Yeah, Rohan, I can hear you.
All right, just allow us a minute, please. Let's get Samir back.
Maybe I can pitch in by the time Samir comes in. And, you know, Samir was talking about the length and the breadth and the depth of the expertise that needs to be built across. So when we talk about breadth, we are talking about cross-discipline competencies. And in terms of depth, we are talking about the depth of discipline that we need to build across these different competencies. So breadth could be defined as, you know, talking about different technologies, different industries. While when we talk about the depth, you know, we are talking about how deep we can go in terms of building some of these algorithms, in terms of understanding the domain, you know, in terms of understanding the analytical approaches that we need to take. Moving on, you know, when we talk about the skills, we are talking about the algorithm theory, the applied math, you know, in terms of how a firm understanding of algorithm theory is required, you know, how some of the concept, the understanding of some of the concepts around gradient descent, convex optimization is needed. There are a lot of AI libraries and developer tools that are being developed. And, you know, it's important for anyone who wants to build a career in AI and analytics to know the mainstream libraries. And the examples of these libraries are TensorFlow, Caffe, PyTorch. And at the same point in time, you know, how some of the tools like R and Python can be utilized for iterative modeling, you know, scale up for someone to be able to scale for two distributed computing.
Devesh, just 1 second, please. Samir, are you back? Devesh, please carry on.
So moving on, you know, we still continue on the different kind of skills that are required to move into the AI and analytics arena. And while we spoke about the libraries, while we spoke about some of the algorithm theories, it's also important to understand, you know, some of the human thought processes from an NLP, from natural language processing perspective, the context behind that, the intent behind that, that helps, you know, the way NLP helps in terms of building the contextual understanding on the same. And a very important component out here is building conceptual thinking, which requires, you know, which will enable the deep understanding of how an AI algorithm makes the decisions the way it does, and how we can reduce the black box component to the maximum extent possible. So these are some of the skills that we have called out, you know, as we understand. And the last one that we have is also in terms of what Samir was earlier talking about, the ability of problem solving. You know, and how ethical application of this can be implemented. So we are talking about design thinkers because they are the ones who can predict what the consumer does not know. We are talking about understanding some of the the facets of problem solving. So earlier there were the days when we were talking about only problem solving. At this point in time, what is very important is the identification of the problem, the framing or the definition of the problem, and then mapping that, you know, for the machine to understand, you know, how the ideation can be generated. One newer important skill sets that is coming in is ethics, programming in, you know, intelligent machines have possibility of potentially implementing life-altering decisions. We hear a lot of ethical AI related discussions these days. So ethical implementation of AI and analytics will become very important. So if I have to kind of summarize the kind of skills that we've spoken, you know, we're talking about a deep understanding of algorithm theories. We're talking about competencies built on different tools. We're talking about understanding of various methodologies, and very importantly, the problem solving ability that a professional in AI and analytics field needs to have. So that kind of sums up, you know, the overall summary in terms of what is artificial intelligence or where this industry is moving, what kind of applications that we are already seeing in this industry, how it is disrupting the various industries, whether that is retail, life sciences, healthcare, consumer products, the kind of applicability that we are seeing, and very importantly, for someone to move into AI analytics, you know, what does it really takes? We will now switch on to the second segment of this webinar, which is more about 3AI and, you know, why 3AI has been formed, what are the kind of objectives that we are working with as a team, and how this can benefit the students as well as the working professionals, not only to step into the AI and analytics arena, but also enhance. But before that, you know, I would want to call out a problem statement. And that problem statement that we are trying to address, you know, which triggered, which motivated, which encouraged us to found this association, this nonprofit association, is we've spoken about, you know, the applicability, we've spoken about the scope of AI and analytics, the way it's disrupting. That presents a huge amount of opportunity for people to build their careers, because there is the kind of demand that is there, you know, from a deployment standpoint. So while we talk about a resource pool, you know, in different narratives, we hear the kind of resource pool India produces every year, with 50,000 institutions out there, 35 million patients and students enrolling every year into these 50,000 institutions. And there are about 300,000 open positions in the space of AI and analytics, you know, as we speak. This is a figure that has come in from NASSCOM, which has estimated that there are about 300 open positions that we currently have. And over the period of time, 1.5 million technology professionals will be required or will be reskilled into AI and analytics. So while we are talking about a huge amount of resource pool out here, the biggest problem that we have is in terms of the deployability or employability ratios. If you look at it, you know, the top 100 engineering campuses only produces 41% of graduates who are employable. So out of all those 35 million professionals that students that we're talking about, only 41% of them are considered to be employable in an AI or analytics world. The overall employability, if we go beyond 100 engineering colleges, if we take into consideration every educational institute that we have, we are talking about 18% of overall employability ratio. 65% of our current working professionals are struggling to upskill. They lack understanding of the kind of skills, the kind of the kind of competencies that they need to build for them to be able to build a successful career in AI and analytics field. And, you know, the data that we've seen from various organizations, the selection ratio, so when a position is opened in the space of artificial intelligence and analytics, the selection ratio is abysmal. It's 1:35 as we speak. So for every one position, there are about 35 candidates who get interviewed. And out of those 35, one of them takes that position. So that's the kind of problem statement that we're talking about, not only for the students, people who are currently pursuing various graduate, postgraduate courses in different universities, but also for our fellow colleagues who are pursuing their careers as we speak. They may be in a career range of 2 to 6 to 10 years, depending upon which business function and which industry are they believing. So are they working in? So the biggest question for the enterprises out here is for them to be able to address the problems of reskilling for the existing workforce and how they can onboard the new professionals, people who are graduating from these universities. And this is where AI and Analytics Association, we've kind of floated it with a vision that we will be able to help plug this gap through this nonprofit organization by creating that largest network of artificial intelligence and analytics professionals and aspirants in India. So 3AI, you know, this is a question that we've received from some of our members in terms of what are the objectives of 3AI. So when we talk about objectives of 3AI, broadly, we are calling out as 4 different objectives: associate, advocate, advance, and institutionalize. Associate is more about creating that community of AI analytics enthusiasts and thought leaders for the furtherance of emerging technologies in India. Advancing objectives related to advancement of AI is more to develop that ecosystem of continuous learning and deep skilling in AI analytics arena through interventions based upon education, exposure, and experience. I mean, when we talk about learning methodologies, education, exposure, and experience are the three E's of learning and upskilling. We also intend to promote reskilling and upskilling of India's professional workforce in terms of new skills and related professional opportunities. We want to drive policy advocacy enhancements in AI analytics with policymakers and influence through policy discussions and helping to create an agenda that advances the value exchange, capital formation, and user protection. And lastly, as part of institutionalization, we want to share the collective knowledge, the experience, and our enthusiasm for AI applications with wide audience, including coordination at the grassroots advocacy with corporates, entrepreneurs, and the users. So those are the four objectives that we are currently working with that we've outlined for this association in terms of what we want to fulfill as we grow, creating in terms of creating this ecosystem for AI analytics professionals and aspirants. If we talk about the advantages, you know, what is it that 3AI brings to the table? You know, so we first and foremost, we are talking about the experiencing, you know, the experience that the members of 3AI get through the FaceTime with the top AI and analytics experts for them to be able to gain first-hand insights and personal mentoring sessions. A lot of our members, you know, who are currently on the line as we speak, they've already started to get invites for their one-to-one mentoring sessions with some of the industry's top leaders, whether that's Samir, we have Dr. Avik Sarkar on the line at this point in time, and I'm going to introduce him in a moment. We have Annapurna, we have a lot of our thought leaders and mentors who have already set up that one-to-one time with our members. We are also talking about contextualized learning with deep technology and domain interfaces. We are speaking about placement opportunities, the largest repository of AI and analytics case studies and application areas. There are about 100 articles that we've already uploaded on our resource library, which you know, to which the members have an exclusive access. And we are in the process of uploading another 100 articles over the period of next 1 week. 3AI interventions also help the members to get to know the topical trends and also come across career-shaping opportunities in AI and analytics sphere. And last but not the least, we have brought together a vast pool of academic institutions, learning organizations, enterprises, and creating that startup ecosystem, you know, which will allow us to bring together top-of-the-line ecosystem of academic experts, professional experts, thought leaders, and very, very importantly, change makers. So those are the advantages that we are calling out for, or that we are building out, you know, for the members to ensure that they have enough resource pool, they have enough understanding for them to be able to enhance their career in the space of AI and analytics. Now, how do we do this?
Devesh, I'll just step in. This is Samir. If you go back to the previous slide. I think one of the key things, and I'm sorry, I just broke up in between and glitches happen when you don't expect. And sometimes you believe AI and analytics cannot solve these tech glitches. But having said that, what I think Devesh said nicely in terms of the key purpose, I think outside of what we are trying to do as part of our larger vision, I think one of the challenges as I have grown through this analytics AI career in the last 17 years of my 22, what I've spent in this industry, one of the initial bane or the challenges I've always realized, whom do I reach out to if I have a problem of understanding what way the industry is going? Because it's been so fast today, the velocity of change is very, very unprecedented. We don't know how our careers will shape up 5 years, forget about 5 years now, 2 years from now. The second aspect about if I have specialized, let's say, in life sciences analytics and I want to change, maybe one of to another adjacent industry, what's the way to go about that? Third, there are deficits today in terms of thought leaders and influencers and experts in analytics. You open up LinkedIn and Facebook, you will realize everyone is an AI head. But being in industry, we realize It's not the case. AI and analytics prowess, expertise only come in when you solve business challenges, when you are live into the client's environment, when you have set up center of excellence, when you know what's the solution you need to give to the clients. And that's why we've been very selective in picking up the thought leaders and mentors and influencers on the platform who have solved client challenges. And this is where what we say, contextualized learning comes to the picture. And this is the kind of information, advice, suggestion, inputs, recommendations we would like to pass to all our members. More kind of face-to-face, more kind of a, let's say, up close and personal, more kind of a mentor-mentee relationship, more kind of a networking opportunities. And the whole intent is to kind of really engage them in terms of shaping up their careers, because we realize it's not just about kind of giving the latest and greatest of the content, which anyone can provide. How do you contextualize the content? We plan to bring close to about 300 case studies and application areas in analytics AI on this platform. I can share with my own understanding, no one has that today. These are the live problems which have been solved, executed, impact-driven scenarios. And then engage with the whole ecosystem of academics, startups, learning organizations. So tomorrow, whether you are a student or a professional aspiring to get into some program in terms of AI analytics, we can give you those real kind of, let's say, nuggets of information. What's the right program you should be doing and what's a program you should not be doing. So these are some of the initial concepts we have built, but the whole intent is the beauty of this association will always be whether we are 200 members or let's say 10,000 members, it has to be very, very, I would say, close, personal and intimate relationship we want to build with you guys in terms of understanding your needs and accordingly tweaking the whole charter and maybe the aspect in terms of how we work with you. Over to you, Devesh.
Thanks, Amir. So moving on in terms of, you know, after having discussed why we are there, what are we doing, it's important to quickly present a view in terms of how we are doing it. So we've outlined seven different types of interventions, you know, 3AI Nurture, which is the one-to-one mentoring program, which Sameer just spoke about. 3AI Connect is a unique platform that we are creating for each of the members to be able to connect with each other. We are forming special interest groups. We are bringing in discussion boards wherein the members can post their problems and some of the other members can help them solve those problems. 3A Insights is basically referring to the repository of articles, blogs, videos, podcasts that we have, which provides that topical understanding on various AI and analytics related interventions. Academy is more of that face-to-face, instructor-led, personalized learning interventions through by way of seminars, by way of webinars, as we are doing right now, by way of different symposiums and conferences that 3AI would be organizing over the period of time. And lastly, we have also built in an assessment program, which we will be launching in the second quarter of this year, you know, towards June or July. And this assessment program will provide opportunity for members to be able to assess themselves on various AI and analytics related skills and get certified. And we are working with institutions, we are working with recognized bodies for us to be able to ensure that the certification from 3AI has that level of standing in the industry that when it's presented, you know, it's taken on its face value. We are also creating an opportunity for the members to get involved, for them to be able to enhance their professional development, the soft skills, you know, for them to be able to part of our speaker community, for them to be able to part to the research that we conduct and put on their articles, blogs, and very importantly, also be part of our mentor bureau. Lastly, we will be setting up programs for helping the members for them to be able to find right opportunities in the space of AI and analytics. There are a lot of details that are there with regards to each of these interventions on 3AI.in. I would really encourage each one of you to kind of visit 3AI.in and you know, read through the details of each of these interventions. Sameer spoke about the thought leaders and mentors, and we've been working with a number of our thought leaders and mentors and ensuring we are bringing in people who really, really have that contextual understanding, experience of solving business problems. And what you see on the screen is our current list of thought leaders and mentors. You've been hearing me and Sameer. We have Rohan, who is currently a co-founder and chief client officer for AI Curate. Sara is head of analytics for Citibank. Nanda has been bringing a lot of experience from the industry and currently is a co-founder and chief technology officer for AI Curate. We have Dr. Avik Sarkar, who is a faculty at Indian School of Business, working in the areas of data, emerging technologies, and public policy. Dr. Avik Sarkar was the former head of data analytics cell and officer on special duty at Niti Aayog. We have Kapil Gandhi as part of our Thought Leadership and Mentor Bureau. And Kapil is an industry innovative thought leader, and he's currently heading the digital strategy and innovation function at Genpact. And he has also worked in the past with Nike, with Ericsson, Syngenta, and EY. Then we have Saujanya Shetty. Saujanya Shetty heads up the business development function for various verticals for Microsoft. We have Annapurna. Annapurna is a thought leader, bringing in 25 years of rich experience in HR operations, change management, and organizational development. And last but not the least, we have Sundara Ramalingam, who recently joined us as a thought leader, and he is head of deep learning practice at NVIDIA India. Moving on to 3AI Ambassadors, this is a program that we've just launched for some of our members for us to be able to strengthen the relationship between them, our executive members, and thought leaders. We have posted the details of our ambassador program on 3AI.in, in terms of what is it that is required for a member to be nominated, identified as a 3AI ambassador, in terms of what are the roles and responsibilities that we expect these ambassadors to be playing, and very importantly, the kind of exposure, the kind of personal branding opportunities that the 3AI ambassadors get in that enhanced volunteer capability. So the ambassadors are helping us in terms of achieving our objectives that we've outlined for 3AI while we create this largest ecosystem for AI and analytics professionals and aspirants. So that was pretty much it in terms of 3AI, what are our objectives, what are the different interventions that we have, and very importantly, how the members of 3AI can benefit from the interventions for them to be able to build and scale their career in AI and analytics. If you have, need more details, obviously we are there for questions at this stage. A lot of these details are also available on 3AI. We are celebrating International Women's Day, which as part of which we are obviously offering 10% off on the registration fee for any women applicants for the membership of 3AI. Over to you, Rohan.
Thank you, Divish. So I've received 4 or 5 questions, but before that, any questions anybody would like to raise? All right, then until somebody intervenes and asks a question, I'm just going to start asking the first few. So the first question actually is 3AI similar to all the training organizations like Coursera or Udemy out there? Do we conduct trainings? Sameer, would you like to take that question?
So first of all, we are not a training organization. We are not a skilling company. We are not an event management outfit. As Devesh alluded and highlighted, it's an association, not for profit, being driven by the sole intent of creating an ecosystem where members can join, get to know about the opportunities, the career opportunities in this area. And many of you may not be aware, it's about 285 opportunities which exist in AI and analytics in terms of jobs, roles, and career ladders. Now, that's one, given that we come from this industries and industry, and we've been very passionate about how exactly this learning needs to be disseminated. And the thing around pertinent to the question is more about getting the ecosystem behind, whether it's a learning company like Coursera to UpGrad to, let's say, academic institutions like the IIMs, IITs and all, and ensuring that the members get the best of the exposure about what's the latest and greatest. And not to forget, as we mentioned, putting up the best of the content, including the bespoke, customized, impactful case studies and scenarios over there, which have been tried, implemented in the client environment. And also, which is our unique feature, those networking, one-on-one mentoring opportunities with the mentors. So in all, it's a platform. It's a kind of a, let's say, arena where the members can come in and experience in a truly individualistic manner what they should be knowing and what they would like to know about AI and analytics.
Thank you, Sameer. Next question. I'm going to paraphrase a bit. I have 8 years experience in IT and I'd like to make a shift to analytics. Will my past experience be considered for my new role fitment? Sameer, would you like to take that?
Rohan, can you just repeat the question again, please?
Sure. I have 8 years experience in IT. I would like to make a move into analytics. Would my past skills be transferable?
So that's a good question. And first of all, welcome to the club. You're not the alone one. Today, 2.1 million of the 4.4 technology professionals I talked about exist in this space. Technology shifts have happened, cycles of new age technologies, exponential technologies have come in, and AI is at the frontier of that. More important today is for one, you to understand what area in AI and analytics you should go or you should get into, which leverages your past experience. We always tend to forget it's not the domain, it's not about the technology, it's about the learnability which gets executed on the floor right in front of the client. So if you are in an area where it's more about technology and the new set of technology like AI has come, and there are various roles, programs you can go into which can leverage your past experience. A case in point today is that when we talk about a shift to many of us who are getting into DevOps side of the things, the applications of artificial intelligence in DevOps is immense. Predictability of kind of understanding the legacy application and sunsetting the kind of, let's say, dated tools and technique is driven by AI today. And so on, there are multiple opportunities. I think there are a lot of areas. More important is for you to kind of pick up how you need to get into those things. And also kind of, let's say, if possible, you can schedule sessions with one of us to make you more clear in terms of what these opportunities are and what kind of programs of learning you can take to build up or rather rebuild up your career.
Sameer, I'm going to take a question from Ankur right now. Ankur, do you want to just repeat a question or I can read it out also?
Up to you, Rohan.
All right, I'll read it out. So, are there any differences in the adoption of AI across industries? Which industries have been pioneers and which are laggards? Sameer, would you like to take this one?
So I think here is the thing, Ankur. The fact over there, as you can relate in the deck and many of us can experience, it's gone through a multiple change in terms of how AI has evolved. It's a 20-year-old industry, close to about almost $164 billion, growing at a CAGR of 17%. Now, if we look from a aspect about the adoption, from an analytics point of view, banking, insurance, retail, and healthcare have been the earlier adopters. When I say healthcare, of course, they were late in terms of the start, but I've picked up over the last 10 years immensely in terms of what the consumerization has done in terms of the new data points which have come in. Now, that segment of these 3 to 4 industries itself consume almost 70% of analytics spend and adoption. Now the rest 30%, which is the sum total of other industry, are now taking up leapfrogging approach. But the best part about these other industries, which are not in the first 4 or 5 industries in terms of adoption, their rate of scalability of AI adoption is much faster than the traditional kind of industries who have been pioneers in terms of adopting AI, because regulations have come in hard and fast in banking and insurance, and the maneuverability to kind of experiment, the whole aspect of what the art of possible is all about AI sometimes gets more, I would say, restricted if these are being worked upon in regulated industry. And that's where the other industries are opening up in terms of taking much more experimental approach to kind of try new kind of a models, techniques, and frameworks to drive more AI adoption.
Thank you. Next question from Anshuman. It's a very contextual question to life sciences. So Devesh, I'm going to put this at you. In the life science space, In the life science space, RWE violates personal data privacy. How does the AI industry overcome privacy issues at large and move forward?
Sure. Thanks, Rohan. So Anshuman, first of all, I would put a correction out there. You know, I do not think that the RWE is violating the personal data privacy. When we talk about real world evidence, you know, from which the real world data is generated, now there are various components of real world data, you know, and real world data could be your EHR data, which is, you know, emergency health records, or electronic health records, or it could be your emergency electronic medical records. So I don't think the RWE data violates the privacy laws as such. Now, coming back to your question with regards to how AI interventions are helping protection of this data. So there are various companies, you know, for example, DataWand, RoyWand, these are the different companies that are there out in the marketplace who are working with clinical research organizations, with the pharmaceutical companies in terms of tokenization of this data. Now, what tokenization essentially means is, you know, it means the de-identification, the masking of the data, by way of which every data point that is coming in from a particular patient is getting de-identified by attributing some token numbers to that. There is a concept of blockchain that is being applied at this stage. So let me take an analogy of the music industry. So the way you have each music or, you know, song title, and you can, the owner of that song title can decide on which song can be passed on to which region, geographical region, and which, you know, and which geographical region should not have access to it. Similarly, blockchain is currently being deployed as part of this tokenization of RWE data, by way of which the data owner, in many cases, the data owners are, you know, the companies like Symphony, in some scenarios, it could be IQVIA. They decide based upon their contracts with, you know, with the patients and all, on which data the different healthcare entities can access, and what are the segments of the data that the healthcare company or different entities cannot access. So
I'll just request you to take a brief here. Probably you can take it offline. We have 3-4 more questions I'd like to please take.
So I was just about to finish out there. So a good example out there is tokenization, where AI and blockchain is playing a very important role. Hope that answers.
All right. Guys, I'm just going to take some discretion now in picking up the questions. We have a lot of them. We have time for only 2 more. I'm going to take a question from Vinod Raman. This is regarding students. What should an MBA student do in the next 1 year to skill up in the AI domain? Would you like to take that?
Sure. So 3 things. One, it's a realization one should have. You're playing a catch-up game, because AI and analytics is already an area which is there for 20 years. So it's not just about doing a program or an MBA which will count in terms of just saying, okay, I can do analytics as well. So as Devesh mentioned in his set of slides, the ratio of kind of selection is 1:30, 1:35 in terms of AI analytics. And that continues to be a challenge because, one, it's not about tools and techniques you should be knowing. It's more about the applicability. Be conversant with a couple of industries which you are passionate about and learn about the top 10 business challenges and how those top 10 business challenges can be solved using analytics and AI. Second, get into Kaggle. That's a tool, that's a platform which can also give you enough enormous number of applications to solve. You can have your own Kaggle score. Third, network, get exposed to the people who have understanding and kind of people who have done it in this kind of a field. Not the ones who claim out to be AI heads on the LinkedIn, but the ones who have really done set of the projects, multiple assignments, which can tell you what are the problem they have faced when it comes to doing the right set of work in analytics and AI. So that's my version of how you can get into this field and prosper.
All right, I think we've run out of time. For the other people who have sent the questions, we will respond to you on mail and we'll mark everybody. I would like to thank everybody for joining the webinar. Very grateful for your participation. Thank you, Samir, Divesh, for sharing your knowledge and taking the questions. With that, I think we'll bring this to an end.
Thanks, everyone. More of these webinars in the time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Devesh. Thank you, Samir.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.